Hello, you have arrived at the Silent Comedy Watch Party, episode 20. Unbelievable. We're so glad you're here. The show has not begun. Your computer is not running fast.
Happy Sunday, everybody.
Happy Sunday. We always go live a little early just so you know you're in the right place. I'm here in my living room with my wife, Mana.
Hi, guys.
And my acoustic piano. And Steve's across town. We'll be joining you momentarily. But you have arrived in the right place. You still have a little time.
If you're on the East Coast, like we are, you can microwave some popcorn. Or if you're on the West Coast, our friends on the West Coast, it's lunchtime. So you can make yourself a little lunch to watch movies by. And if you're our friends in Europe or Scandinavia, Stockholm, and where else? Brazil and...
Argentina,
everywhere else in the world.
Denmark.
Yeah, maybe it's time for a nightcap or even your morning coffee.
Yeah, so we're so glad you're here. Here's a little music. Thank you.
Happy Sunday,
folks. And I switched mics. I remember this time. Thanks, Mana. Thanks for getting the lights. Thank you. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party, streaming to you live from right here. This is happening live. This is happening right now.
From our living room. On the Upper West Side of Manhattan.
On the Upper West Side, exactly. And from Steve Massa's on his place in the Upper East Side. We'll bring him out in a moment. Thanks so much for tuning in again, sharing links, etc. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party, streaming weekly, live on YouTube for free, co-hosted live by myself and Steve Massa, and live accompanied right from my piano into a mic and right out of your speaker. The scores are improvised, so what's happening is just for you. As always, behind the camera is my wife, Mana.
Hi, everybody. Glad you could join us today.
Yes, and we were remarking earlier in the week that this was episode 20. We should have got a cake or something. Maybe for the 25th. Also want to thank Across the Park helping Steve out, his wife, Susan.
Yay.
And I'll just bring it up because I love the graphic. This is our graphics are designed by the amazing Marlene Weissman.
Woohoo!
And our associate producer in Pennsylvania is Crystal Curry. And thank you so much, Crystal, for everything you do, Crystal. keeping me organized and getting stuff out the door when it needs to get out there. We've got a great show for you today. Oh, by the way, if you notice when you're watching that I appear, or Steve appears, way, 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 way out of sync, try refreshing your browser. That sometimes helps. But Susan is watching, and if the sync drifts or something, she's going to text Mona, and I'll hit something. We'll get that all sorted out for you. It is August 2nd, 2020, episode 20 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party. Let's see, I covered... Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. And... thanks for those of you who sent in a contribution. We appreciate it. It's not why we're doing this show, but we appreciate your support, and we're set up for that on Patreon, Square, et cetera, et cetera. And I'll tell you the links later. We've got a great show for you today. Three great comedies, two one-reelers and a two-reeler. And they're films that are not only hilarious, but I'm pretty sure they only survive because 16 millimeter prints were made for the home use markets. But we've got a great show. So to tell you more about our first film, which I think you'll really enjoy, here is Steve.
Hey.
Hi, Steve.
Hi, Steve.
Hey, hi, Ben. Hi, Mona. Hi, everybody. Thanks Hello. For tuning in.
Yeah, yeah. So you want to tell folks about PEP UP, our first short okay. of the day. Yeah.
PEP UP. Yeah, PEP UP. Well, this is a 1929 cameo comedy, which was produced by Jack White. Jack White had various series in the 1920s. The average kind of his two-reel brand were called mermaid comedies. He also had a series with kids that was named juvenile comedies. But then he had a one-reel series. Here we go. And the one-reel series was cameo comedies. They started around 1922 with Jimmy Adams and Virginia Vance. And then they continued on through the 20s. And Cliff Bowes, who stars in PEP UP, was probably his main star of cameo comedies. Cliff Bowes starred in a lot of these, and they, you know, because they were one-reelers, they turned out a lot of these. And so Cliff Bowes was a little bit of the poor man's Lige Conley, as far as Jack White comedies were concerned.
If you know Jack who Lige White Conley is.
yeah, exactly. Yeah. So Lige Conley was starring in the two-reel mermaid comedies, and then Cliff Bowes was doing the one-reel cameo comedies. But Bowes had worked. He started at Mack Sennett. He had been a champion diver, so he's a real athlete. He started at Sennett in the teens, and then he kind of moved around. He worked with Al St. John. He worked with different people. But then his home through most of the 1920s were Jack White comedies. And the cameos continued until 1929, until sound came in. So PEP UP is sort of in the last batch of cameo comedies from 1929. But it's really, you know, it's a really nice, and it's very rare. It survives on a 16 millimeter Kodoscope.
Yeah.
So it's a very rare little film. And he has support from people like Adrian Doré. You'll see a little comedian kind of plays the butler, in Harry Langdon type. He's a forgotten comedian named Billy Dale. Character actress Emily Gerdes is in it, but we can talk, you know, more about everybody after the show, the movie. I mean,
yeah, exactly. Thanks, Steve. And just so you know, what Steve was mentioning, Kodoscope was a film library like Blockbuster was with VHS, back in actually 16 millimeter hit the market itself as a home movie format from Kodak in 1923, and 2 years later. The Kodoscope Library opened, and within a year or two, several other libraries, like the Ideal Library and Home Film Libraries, released copies. It was just, we'll get these films you could see in the theater a year or so ago, and we'll make 16mm prints, and you can rent them and have them and send them back. And it turns out a lot of these films are lost, and they only survived because these things were, as I now call it, accidentally preserved. Nobody thought of it as preservation, but they're really rare, they're fun, and they're sharp. So, and that's why you'll notice a slight amber, salmonish kind of tint, because the films often were on colored film stock. Mm-hmm. So you knew it wasn't your home movies, and they often smell like camphor. So look for that at flea markets when you get to go back to one. So I'm going to take Steve's mic out, and let's now enjoy from 1929. Yes, Mona.
Did we get this from an archive?
No, this is something we have Rob Arcus to thank.
Oh, thank you,
for
Rob.
Helping us track this print down.
Yay.
Yep. Okay, so now, thank you, Mona. Get the lights. Here is from 1929. Here is Pep. Thank you. Thank you very much.
It's such a funny movie.
Yeah, yeah. Can you get the lights, please? Sure. Thank you. That was Pep Up, starring Cliff Bowes. And those of you who have it handy, if those of you who have a copy of the Douglas MacLean collection DVD might have recognized Emily Gurtis, because she's in one of the Douglas MacLean films. But that's just a plug. To tell you a little bit more about this rare film we got to see, here's Steve.
Yeah, I mean, this is very rare. I think it does only survive because of the 16 millimeter print. But it's very short and sweet. I mean, it moves along real fast, and it's really only a couple of incidents, you know, before where Cliff's coming with the dog and he thinks the big dog ate the little dog. And then when he gets to the dance itself or the party, and that's kind of it, really.
Yeah.
Emily Gurtis, who Ben mentioned before, she plays Adrian Doré's mother. And, you know, her big scene is the dance with Cliff when they have the bugs on them. But she was really a wonderful character actress. She's in a lot of the silent comedy shorts. I mean, she kind of reminds me of Miss Prissy from the Foghorn Leghorn cartoon.
Yeah.
You know, she could have played that character. She's in a lot of shorts and in features, too. Her best known role is she plays Prissy Pill in Colleen Moore's Ella Cinders.
So, she's one of the stepsisters.
Kind of mean stepsisters.
Yeah.
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 But she worked all through the 20s and into the sound era. But her parts are smaller in the sound era, and she tends to play kind of pioneer women. Mm. You know, she turns up in westerns in the 30s. She's like in The Grapes of Wrath and things, you know, doing bit parts. Adrienne Doré, who's the leading lady, she was a singer. She had appeared at the Coconut Grove in Los Angeles, and she was also a runner-up for Miss America. She was Miss Los Angeles in 1925. Wow. And, you know, movies came knocking pretty quickly after that, and she appeared in a number of lots of shorts, and then she became a regular in these cameo comedies in, like, 1928 and 1929. She stars in one from this period called, has an odd title, Delicious and Refreshing. It's a strange title, and she's teamed up with Big Blanche Payson.
Oh,
so I don't know which of them is delicious and which is refreshing. But it's a strange little short at a party, and they're dancing, and there's all this. So she starred in these, and then when sound came in, she still appears in a lot of shorts for Christie, and she had some good roles in features in the early 30s, but her career is kind of over by the late 1930s. And then there's Little Billy Dale, who plays the butler, you know, who creates all the problem with the bug spray.
He looks like if you crossed me with Harry Langdon, you'd get him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wait, he looks a little like Barney Hallam.
That's true, yeah.
Who was in the Max Sennett comedies and ended up playing Barney Google.
Yeah, so that's right.
But he was a vaudevillian. He spent years in vaudeville. And he also was a Hal Roach gag writer. He wrote
this is Billy Day.
Billy Dale.
Yeah.
He wrote gags for Snub Pollard and Paul Parrott shorts and Hal Roach in the 20s. But he was friendly with Charlie Parrott. He's credited as co-writing a song with Charles Parrott and Jimmy Adams in the 20s. Oh. But between his vaudeville engagements, he sort of, like Adrian Doré, ended up appearing in a bunch of these cameo comedies. I mean, there's some that star him. And then after that, it's like back to vaudeville, but he didn't seem to do much in the way of films.
Yeah.
And the director was a guy named Francis J. Martin, who was really a comedy writer. He had written a lot of stuff, and he got a gig directing a lot of these 1929 cameos. He directed some with Vernon Dent and other people. And when sound came in, he pretty much continued comedy writing through the 30s. His one directorial credit for a feature was Tilly and Gus with the W.C. Fields and Alison Skipworth, which a lot of the critics say was poorly directed. So he didn't direct too much, unfortunately, after that. But and I don't think Fields got along with him too well.
Yeah.
And Fields didn't get along with most of his directors.
Yeah.
So, and also one last thing. There's at the very end where Cliff is losing his clothes and he grabs the raincoat. The little guy he buys it from, I'm pretty sure, is Bobby Barber, who was a character actor and great friend of Lou Costello. He's in all the Abbott Costello films. And
All right.
He often played waiters and, you know, into the 1950s. But he's in a lot of Jack White comedies at this time.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I wasn't going to question it or anything, but if you say it's Bobby Barber, it's probably him.
It really looks like him, although you don't see him very much.
He's just a quick bit. Quick,
but he's the right height, and, you know, he looks like Bobby, so I'm pretty sure, because he turns up in a lot of these.
Yeah, if he's working there at the time, all right.
Yeah.
Close enough for me. So let's tee up our next short, Love's Young Scream, which I think is a play on words on Love's Young Dream.
Yes.
I've seen there's a bunch of comedy shorts with this title, but this is an interesting film. Also survives, as far as I know, pretty much on 16mm. I'll talk a little bit about how I put Humpty Dumpty back together with this in a little bit. But Steve, why don't you talk about what we're about to see?
Sure. This is a 1928 Al Christie comedy. Now, I don't think we've shown. Oh, we showed Wild Men Go Wild, which was Christie comedy.
Really, Christie, yeah.
And Christie was one of the three biggest silent comedy shorts producers after Max Sennett and Hal Roach. Although his name doesn't have quite the same ring as the other two today, but you know, for 30 years he turned out all kinds of great comedy shorts, and this is part of his. Well, actually, I think the actual star is Anne Cornwall.
Yes.
Who you'll see.
Yeah, her name's on the title card, main title card.
Yeah, she did a series for him, and she's usually supported in these by Jack Duffy. And he was a Christie star, and he's remembered today because he played kind of a foxy grandpa character. He played this sort of, you know, very active old man, except Duffy was really in his 40s. But with makeup and taking out his dentures, he played this great character, and he's very funny. He was a wonderful comedian.
Yeah.
And he had his own series as well for Christie. And this Christie is 28, so it's earlier Christie had released his films through Educational. But in the last part of the silent era, he released them through Paramount. And this is one of the Paramount distributed shorts. And these are very rare. A lot of these haven't survived, or they've only survived in truncated version, which Ben will tell you about later.
Yeah.
So I think that's, I mean, this is the way this survives. It is in a cut down. It was originally a two reeler.
Yeah.
And only this kind of section, parts of the film survive today.
Yeah. Yeah. This is, it's like a 1.5 reeler at the current length. It's about 14 minutes. But this is a film. Yes, Mona.
Can you just, for our viewers at home that may not know what a split reeler
or
one reeler or two reeler.
Yeah. So when they had film, the long ribbon of celluloid, you would wrap it around and around and around on a reel. A reel held 1,000 feet of film. It holds 1,000 feet of film, which can be anywhere from 8 or 9 minutes, depending on, to 14 minutes, depending on how much film is on the reel and what speed it's being shown at. But short comedies were devised as a single reel or a double reel, and earlier on there were split reel films that were just 5 minutes. Just a quick, often it's a prank or it's a short idea, and you could take them all and use them as interstitials on television now. So what we're going to see now is Love's Young Scream from 1928. And you'll see it in two, I combined two different 16mm prints. One that I had that had its original intertitles in it. And then another one that fills out a good deal more of the film that came from a collector named Dennis Atkinson. Allowed me to scan his print, which was a print made in the 50s for television, where they spliced out all the titles and put in jokey narration. But I was able to figure out what the missing titles were by going by the narration. So some of the intertitles are from the older blurrier print, some are from the newer print, and some I made a few years ago, so they're going to look really sharp. So there's nothing wrong with your set. You'll get to see Love's Young Scream as complete as it can be without owning a time machine. Okay, so, Monica, you got the lights?
Sure.
Thank you very much. Okay, all right, I've got it into third gear. And so let's enjoy Love's Young Scream, starring Anne Cornwall from 1928.
Happy ending.
And there's nothing like getting married at the last second to wind up a silent comedy short. Well, can you get the lights, please, Mom?
Sure.
Thanks. Yeah, that's something. Well, you've been watching for almost 20 weeks or less, and you've seen people get married in the last 20 feet of a film, and you've seen that corner on Larchmont Boulevard in Los Angeles that we saw in the Cliff Bows many, many, many times. Steve, want to fill in some details on this for our friends watching today?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's a great little short, very well directed, lots of action. The direction was William Watson, who was a silent comedy veteran. He was the uncle of Coy Watson Jr., who's a kid who's in a lot of these silent comedies, and his brother was Coy Watson Sr. And William Watson, you know, they lived right near the Senate studio, Keystone Studio, in the early teens. So he started working in the lab for Senate, and then he became an editor. He became a film editor for Keystone. But eventually he went over to Fox Sunshine Comedy and became a director. And through the 20s and 30s, he directed a lot of stuff, a lot of Christie's, Billy Dooley comedies. He directed a lot of those. In early sound, he directed some of Lloyd Hamilton comedies, which are very good early sound films. So he was a real pro. He worked for years. The cartoons that are on the original titles were drawn by Norman Z. McLeod. Now, McLeod had been a cartoonist, but he got into films and he was a gag man and did these cartoons for Christie comedies. But in the 1930s, he became a director of features.
That's where I know his name, yeah.
Yeah, he directed a lot of famous films. He directed Monkey Business and Horse Feathers for the Marx Brothers. He directed, you know, It's a Gift, one of W.C. Field's masterpieces. He directed Topper. He directed Pale Face with Bob Hope. But he was kind of known for staying out of the way of the main comedian and, you know, letting them do what they did. So he was very successful as a director that way because, you know, he and I think he had a real sharp comedy mind as well. So he knew that these comedians could take care of themselves, I think. So he just let them go.
Yeah.
But he directed a lot of successful films. But he got his start at Christie. And Anne Cornwall, she had been a chorus girl. She had appeared in shows with the Dolly Sisters. And she got into films. She did some things for Universal. Serious things, various kind of features she appeared in. And then in the mid-20s, she started working at Christie with people like Bobby Vernon, you know, being their leading lady. But then Christie sort of gave her own series where she's headlined. And in a lot of these, Jack Duffy appeared as her grandpa, you know, in a lot of these films. And she didn't do much in sound. She's one of the girls in Men of War with Laurel and Hardy.
Oh, right.
Two girls that they meet, and she's funny in that, but she didn't do too much else. Maybe she retired, I don't know. And of course Duffy, you know, he was the brother of Kate Price, who was sort of, yeah, she's the
right,
perennial silent comedy Irish woman, you know,
right,
working woman. She's in
tons
of shorts.
And she's great.
Yeah, she had her own series at Vitagraph, and then she was in a lot of the Mary Pickford and Colleen Moore features. She was in the Cohen and Kelly films, you know, she was in the first of those. So she, and that was, Jack Duffy was her younger brother. Huh. And he ended up in vaudeville, and he started working in films around 1918. And in the early 20s, he hit upon this old man character. And, you know, he removed his dentures and pretty good makeup. And, I think he's very funny. I like his series a lot.
He's also really athletic.
He's very athletic. Yeah. Well, he's you know, half the age he's portraying, so he could get away with it, I guess.
At this point, he's in his early 40s.
Yeah.
But he is, you know, even for his early 40s, he's very athletic.
Oh yeah, definitely.
But the illusion of him as an old man, I think, really works.
Comedic. Yeah.
So he's very funny. He did the character a little bit into the beginning of Sound, but then he retired from performing and became a makeup man at the studios. But he passed away in 1939. So, you know, he never lived to be as old as his character in his films, unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah. But he's a face that was even recognizable to me after a while. He keeps turning up as somebody's grandpa or something. He just keeps turning up and he worked for everybody practically.
He did. In the early 20s, he worked a lot for Larry Seaman. He's even in a couple of Roach films where he plays Snub Pollard's grandpa.
Yeah.
You know, Monty Banks. He worked all over. And then once he got in at Christie, he became part of the main support at Christie. But then Christie finally gave him his own series.
And isn't Jack Duffy the guy in Our Hospitality at the back of the train with the horn? Or am I thinking of somebody else? It is Chuck Duffy.
Yes, he is. Yeah. He's also in Neighbors. He's the judge that's trying to marry
in the Keaton
Buster
short Neighbors.
And,
yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, so I mean, he worked with everybody
except Chaplin, as far as we know.
Yeah. Well, he is supposedly in A Dog's Life, but not as the old man.
Oh,
he's in the cafe, you know.
All right, I'll have to look for him.
Yeah, but without his makeup. And he does appear in a couple of early Larry Seamans. You can see him without the makeup.
Oh.
So he plays two roles.
Oh.
And then I think we should mention Glenn Cavender,
who
plays Ann Cornwall's father, is another.
We've seen him almost every other show. He's been in something we've run. I think he's gotten more of a shot in the arm to his reputation through our show than anything else.
Well, like Vernon Dent, he was one of the rocks of silent comedy. You know, he worked at Senate. He's in a lot of the Arbuckle films. He's the Southern general who in Keaton's the general who takes the train and Buster.
Yeah, that's all I'd ever seen him in. I thought, oh, he just plays bad guys in dramas, and then he turns up in all these comedy shorts.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he turned up in a lot of Senate, a lot of Jack White comedies. It's kind of rare that he turns up in Christie, but, you know, here he is. And I've seen him in a Roach or two as well from this period. So he's in features. He just seemed to go from place to place, working constantly. Worked a lot with Lloyd Hamilton.
Yeah.
And then in sound films, again, he continued working, but in small bits.
Yeah.
But he's supposed to have a very colorful background where he worked at Wild West shows and was decorated for being in the Army and all kinds of backgrounds, which may or may not be true. But
Yeah.
That's what he's rumored.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if we want to talk about Hollywood Enterprises and
I can talk just really briefly. But what Steve is referring to is one of the companies that would release movies for the home movie market in little 5-minute cutdowns, and that's what I started with on won it on eBay, and then I was able to fill it out with this other really nice print again thanks to Dennis Atkinson who supplied it for Accidentally Preserved Volume 3 on DVD.
Yay.
So you can see the whole film. Anytime you want, but a lot of times films, it's not like I put Napoleon back together, but sometimes it's fun to put these projects together so people can enjoy the film as they were. And we should probably move on to our headliner now.
The only thing I want to say is Hollywood Enterprises, they released these in theaters in the early 40s.
Oh, they did,
They had the original Christie material.
Right, that's why
it's
pretty sharp if you can get a good print. Yeah,
they cut it up and then they discarded what they didn't use.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
You know,
so anything, anything from Hollywood Film Enterprises that turns up on eBay, maybe one of those kind of prints. They circulated a lot in the 40s and 50s.
That's the only way a lot of these Christies exist.
Exactly. Yeah. So our last film is Fluttering Hearts, with Charley Chase and some other really wonderful people. So Steve. On this, and I should really mention, this is Monica kept asking, what's the one with Oliver Hardy and the speakeasy?
Because
the titles never match, and the slide that, I don't want to give any more spoilers away, but this is a favorite around here. It's a fun short.
This is a wonderful chase. It's from 1927, and it's a really great one, but it doesn't get shown very often.
You know,
it doesn't get shown as much as His Wooden Wedding or Mighty Like a Moose or things like that. But it's really wonderful. Leo McCarey, who had directed a lot of the earlier Chase films, had moved on to directing Max Davidson and became director general of the Roach Studio. So he was supervising, but he was doing other things. So this one is directed by Charlie's brother, James Parrott, who was an excellent comedy director and directed tons of the Laurel and Hardy films. And it's got a great cast, supporting cast. Martha Sleeper is the leading lady, you know, who's really wonderful. And of course, Oliver Hardy's in it. And there's other people like Kay DeLees and other Roach regulars. So,
we should take a look and talk.
Yeah.
And Gene Pellett. So if you're watching this film and thinking, is that Eugene Pellett? Who I only know him from the 30s and 40s with that voice. But that's him.
Yeah, he appeared at this time. He's in a number of Roach films.
Yeah.
No, he was a regular. He worked with Chase a lot. And he's starting to he's not quite as big as he would be in the 30s. But, you know, he's kind of working, because if you see him in Intolerance and films like that, he's relatively slim.
Yeah.
You know?
It's fun seeing him in The Three Musketeers.
Yes.
But anyway, so if you're wondering if that's Eugene Pellett from the Capra films, yes, that's him.
Yep.
So, yeah. So let's get ready to, thanks, turn off the lights. Here we go. Here is Charley Chase in Fluttering Hearts.
And thank you.
much?
I love that movie.
Thank you. Can you get the lights, please? You know, one of the things about this era, and this is something that Steve and I have seen from watching a lot of films from the 20s, that there's a certain point during the 1920s, and once Prohibition is started in 1920 and it goes through 33, the first few years, there's a lot of gags about hiding a flask and hiding this. And then by 1925, 26, people are just getting, they're drinking, they're going to parties, they're going to, there's a lot of speakeasy gags. So it was just, that's how long it took to not really, anyway, but it's fun to see that there is this shift where we go from people, you know, like this, and then like we saw in the Scarecrow, right, to just, this is what we're all doing. And they just had a lot of fun with it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a wonderful short. And it really is a shame that it's not, doesn't get seen more often. Because I think it's one of the great Chase shorts. And the sequence with Oliver Hardy and the mannequin is fantastic. And Ollie's so good in this. I mean, he couldn't be better.
Yeah. You know?
But the whole cast, Martha Sleeper is wonderful.
She's wonderful. Yeah.
Yeah. And she was born in 1910, so she's still only 17 at this point. You know?
Wow.
She's pretty young, but she's, you know, she was a dancer. She started in films when she was 12. She appeared in some Buddy Messenger comedies. He had a gang, so she was like one of the members of the gang at Universal. And then Roach hired her. I think initially it seemed that he hired her for Our Gang. And she is in a couple, but she's way too mature.
Yeah, she aged out, yeah.
Yeah, she's just, even though she was young, she's too mature. So right away in 1924, you know, she becomes leading lady for Charley Chase and people like that. And she's, all the time she spent at Roach, and, you know, she's often Max Davidson's daughter and things like Pass the Gravy, which are masterpieces. And she left Roach around this time in 27, and then she appeared in some features. In the 30s, they put her in a lot of dramatic things. It didn't really make use of her real talents. And she was frustrated, and she left New York and moved, or she left California and moved to New York. And during the 30s and early 40s, she was in about 10 Broadway shows. One was Spencer Tracy called The Rugged Path. But none of them lasted very long. Unfortunately, they weren't hits. And then she kind of retired. And she started making jewelry. We were going to talk about this with something called Bakelite.
Yeah.
Yes.
A lot of her jewelry, it's kind of all very whimsical little animals and things.
Yeah.
And a lot of it's still available on eBay.
Yeah, I just looked last night, and there's a bunch of her stuff. You can search, if you go to eBay and type in Martha Sleeper Bakelite, you know, you have something to give a friend of yours who likes old movies for the holidays or a birthday.
So
there's a lot of stuff available, and it's wonderful.
And she's remembered for that. And then she retired. I think she moved to Puerto Rico and passed away there in the last years of her life. But she's wonderful. James Parrott was a great director, great comedy writer. I mean, it's so well directed. And the actor who plays Martha's father, William Burress, probably makes one of the most attractive women ever. Especially when his wig gets pushed back, you know, the top of
funny.
Him. But he was mostly a dramatic actor. He was, he's from vaudeville, but he was mostly in dramas. But he plays the toy maker in Laurel and Hardy's Babes in Toyland. Later. And then he's kind of mean to them. He yells at them all the time and acts like they're idiots and stuff. But no, he's very good in this. So it's, and Kay DeLeese plays the woman that's sitting with Oliver Hardy. And she was a Roach regular, and she's one of Georgia Hale's girlfriends in the Gold Rush. She's one of the dance hall girls. And so she did a lot of stuff, worked into, she turns up in some Pete Smith things in the 40s. One where it's called Bus Pests. And she's the lady bus driver who's making people sit down. She's a real comedy pro. You know, she worked for years.
Yeah.
So it's a wonderful short.
It's a lot of fun. We've gotten a lot of letters from emails anyway from people asking for more Charley Chase and either that or telling us how great it's been discovering his work, because For some fans, he's completely unknown, yeah. And he's absolutely delightful.
One of my favorites.
Yeah, yeah, he's really, really, really a lot of fun.
Yeah, I call him silent comedy's Renaissance man, because he could do everything.
Yeah.
He wrote and ran. He and Hardy go back to King B together.
Right.
Because Charley was directing some of Billy West's comedies where Hardy was playing like the Eric Campbell heavy.
Yeah.
And so they go way back. And really, I think it was due to Charley that Ollie first ended up at Roach. Because they worked together over the years. So and Chase, he became director general of the studio for a while. And he brought a lot of people in that he had worked with earlier. Yeah. And I think Hardy was a case of that, too, of him recommending it.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, that's great. So that's our program. Hang on, we have some things to share with you. So our cabin fever recommendations. So, Steve, why don't you go first?
Okay. Well, my first cabin fever recommendation is the brand new DVD Blu-ray, Laurel and Hardy, the Definitive Restorations. And they really are. They look gorgeous. You know, some wonderful stuff. It's four discs. There's a lot of material. Two features, Way Out West and Sons of the Desert, but lots of shorts, including the reconstructed Battle of the Century, where you have the first reel with the second reel that was found by John Marsalis. So it's really good. The only drawback that I'll mention, just so you know, is the menus on the discs are very difficult to navigate. And you need to spend a little time with them to figure out how they work. Once you figure it out, they're fine.
Yeah,
so
You need Stan to explain it to you. So you take
take this.
The prophets. Now tell me that again. Yeah.
But it's a wonderful set. It's really good, and it's available right now. It just came out, and the restorations. Kit Parker Films produced. You know, release this, and the restorations from UCLA. But there's plenty of extras and interviews, commentary tracks by Randy Spreadbed and Dick Bam. So it's a great set.
Great. Thanks, Steve. And my first recommendation that I want to share with you is a book called Crazy, George Harriman, A Life in Black and White by Michael Tisserand. Michael is a regular viewer of the show, but this is a book about the life of George Harriman, who drew the Crazy Cat comics, and which was very started in the Crazy Cat series started in the late teens, but went into the 1930s. But the interesting and fun connection to silent comedy is that George Harriman did all of his Crazy Cat drawings at an office on the Hal Roach lot, because he had been friends with Beanie Walker, who wrote all the intertitles and scripts in the 20s and 1930s, and I don't know how it got worked out, but he just parked himself there, and pretty much that's where he did all of his work. So, but it's extremely well written and really deeply researched, and brings out not only his professional work and his professional career, but the fact that was not known until much, much later that Harriman himself is Creole, did not present itself that way, and there's this whole, you know, how do you manage that during a good deal of the 20th century. But it's a great read, and like I said, a strongly recommended book. It's here it is again, because all Crazy, George Harriman, A Life in Black and White, and there are links to all this stuff on our webpage for today's show. And Steve, you have one more to share with everybody.
Yes, I have Chaplin, His Life and Art, and this is by David Robinson, and it's for many years has been the definitive biography of Charlie Chaplin, because you get the whole life, and David, of course, knows more about the work itself, the films itself, than almost anyone. Yeah. So it's and what's available right now is an updated version. So there's, you know, more information that's come in, he's added. But it's one of the quintessential silent comedy books.
Yeah, I think we both reach for it often instead of looking stuff up online, because there's so much great stuff in it.
I got it when it first came out in the early 80s. You know, I couldn't wait. I got it right away, and it was thick at the time. And so it was a big hardback edition I got when it first came out. And yeah, I use it all the time for reference. So it's you know, it really is the, I think, the best book on Chaplin. And there are a lot of books on Chaplin, yeah, but I think it's the best, the most important, the most valuable.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, Steve. Thanks. Sure. And and before we sign off, I just wanted to invite you, if you can manage it right now. I've launched a Kickstarter to produce and distribute a DVD of silent comedy shorts that star Edward Everett Horton. Oh my, oh dear. Yes, that's that guy.
Yeah. Makes silent movies.
You know, he made these films in 1927, 1928. They survive in very good 35 millimeter preservation negatives that were preserved and then given to the Library of Congress. And I'm working, as always, with the Library of Congress to access these films. But there's a Kickstarter running now. I have not looked at the tally. We launched around 12:45 p.m. here in New York. But if you go to Kickstarter, oh, okay. So we'll be completely funded in a little while, as it turns out. Yeah.
It's like,
but it's
like, yeah, $76 more.
Yeah. 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 But we want to, if times are tough right now, if you can support the project, great. It looks like if you can't, it's going to be fine. And I'll have to announce a stretch goal. But if the whole idea is, they're really funny and charming films. They're really well made. They were produced by Harold Lloyd. The production values are great. And just a chance for all of us to work together to get some wonderful silent films back out to fans who want to see them again.
Really rare.
Yeah, they're really rare. And they're lots and lots of fun. So, Steve, I'll bring you up again if you just want to say your sign off.
Say my sign off.
Yeah, well,
The Horton shorts are great, yes, and there are a lot of comedy pros working on it.
Yes.
And so you'll see a lot of regulars, all Harold Lloyd's people. And, you know, his character is the same as his sound character, except you just don't hear his voice, although you can usually hear it in your head because you know his voice so well. But they're really wonderful, and I want to thank everyone for tuning in. I hope everybody stays healthy and safe, and we'll see you next week.
All right. Thanks, Steve.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Ben. Thanks, Mom.
Right. Yeah.
Thanks, Steve.
Yes, and I want to thank you also for watching. This has been the Silent Comedy Watch Party, our 20th episode. Thanks to all of you for watching, and if you watched from the beginning, thank you. It's been quite a ride, and who thought we would still be doing this in August? And it looks like we'll be here every week for the next bunch of months that we need to, as the year goes on, and we all hunker down and stay safe and stay healthy.
And need some laughs.
And need some laughs. So Steve and I are happy to share these great comedy shorts with you for spread the laughs, and we've been so. It's been so wonderful that so many different archives and DVD labels have said yes to helping get these things out to you. So we'll be here. If you're not on my email list, if you go to silentcomedywatchparty.com, you can sign up to get emails. Every time we post a show, you'll get an email. That way you don't have to worry about remembering to look for it on Facebook. If you go to the Silent Comedy Watch Party episode page for this episode. If you go to silentcomedywatchparty.com and then scroll down to episode 20 and click the link, you'll find links to all the things we recommended today, as well as links to throw a dollar into our hat if that works for you right now, and to sign up for our emails. One thing I'd like to see, like I said at the top of the show, it's always great to hear from people as far as where they're watching from, especially outside of the U.S. If you go to the show page, you can definitely post a comment there. It's open for comments. And say, you know, where you're watching from, and maybe a sentence or two about where you first discovered silent movies. And we'll see. Since we can't all see each other, but we're all watching together, it's a way to, you know, to find out where everybody's virtual cinema is. And again, I want to thank Mana, my wife, Mana Allen.
You're very welcome. So nice to spend Sunday with you all.
And thank you.
See you next week.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mana. And thank you, Susan, over at Steve's place.
Yay.
Marlene Weissman, Crystal Kay, and everybody, and especially you, for watching this and enjoying it. We thank you for watching. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party, episode 20, streaming absolutely live to you on August 2nd, 2020, from New York City to you, wherever you are. Stay safe, stay healthy, and keep laughing. We'll see you next week. Thanks.
Have a great week, everybody.